Jennifer Branscombe.
And I'm Alexandra Branscombe.
I'm a member of the World Languages Department at Morristown Friends School. And if there's one thing that my colleagues and I share in common is our love of food. And we're here today to show you how to make a Spanish meal. Prior to the quarantine, Alexandra was studying in Spain and I was planning to go visit her. Instead of all of the amazing meals we were going to eat in Spain, we decided we would try to make one here in our kitchen. What we're gonna make today is called pisto or pisto manchego. The manchego comes from La Mancha, Spain, which is most famous for its literary figure, Don Quixote. Don Quixote was a character in a book by Miguel de Cervantes, which is known as the first modern novel in Western culture.
In the US, we're used to having a smaller lunch and then a bigger dinner, whereas in Spain, they eat a big lunch around 2 p.m. and then a smaller dinner around 10 p.m. So the roles are reversed. Before lunches, as well as sometimes instead of dinners, Spaniards eat tapas, which are small plates. It's a fun Spanish tradition. Tapas can be a range of things. Some of it can be more involved. It can be more like actual hot food that people share. In this case, we're doing bread and chorizo, and jamón, manchego cheese, as well as olives. One thing that's really interesting about Spain and Spanish food is all of the influences from other countries. On this plate here, we have a few examples.
This right here is a fruit called membrillo, which was brought to Spain from the Arabs when they occupied Spain for almost 800 years. This is delicious with queso manchego, sheep's milk cheese that is salty and really rich in flavor. Chorizo is this beautiful red color because of the smoked paprika that was also brought to Spain by the Arabs and is a part of a lot of the Spanish food and it's really delicious. This is Jake Branscombe. Hello, Jake.
Hello.
Hi. Who's here to try our tapas and tell us what he thinks.
They're good. They're like the best thing I've had in like a day. They're really good though.
We're not serving this in the most traditional way, but we do have this ceramic bowl which hot tapas would typically be served in. But this one is from a restaurant called Jose Maria, which is in Segovia. It is a Michelin star restaurant, which I was fortunate enough to go to. And it is famous for cochinillo, which means little pig.
Cochinillo would be a very typical type of food that I would think that they would be eating in 17th century Spain. The author of Don Quixote actually spent significant time in Sevilla. And so there is a pisto manchego, and then there is a pisto andaluz.
I would just add that Sevilla is a city in Andalusia, which is a region in the south of Spain. La Mancha is north, and then Sevilla is in the south, and that was where most of the Arab influence still remains in Spain.
I thought it might be fun if we followed Cervantes to Sevilla and make the Andalusian version of pisto. Recipe for pisto that we were using today is my absolute favorite recipe book from Spain, which is by Penelope Casas. And as you can see, I've used it a lot. Penelope Casas is sort of like the Julia Child of Spain, I think, where she studied abroad in Spain and really fell in love with the food and culture and ended up writing this amazing cookbook that has so many great recipes in it. What she says pisto manchego is a zucchini, green pepper, and tomato medley. We'll also be serving it with fried eggs, which is a typical accompaniment.
A lot of American abroad students ask their host families for eggs in the morning and they give you a very funny look. And that's because in Spain, eggs are really only only eaten at dinner. Fried eggs are like a staple for dinner every night, whether it's with rice, whether it's with a small amount of meat, vegetables.
This is like, I think we're gonna get a safety intervention.
Cervantes published El Quijote in two volumes, and the first volume he published in 1605. Just to give sort of a point of reference, Cervantes died on the same day or one day apart from Shakespeare. Cervantes traveled to Sevilla in search of work and actually was sent to jail for a number of years, where it is said that he developed the idea for writing El Quijote. All of the vegetables that we're cutting, and including in our pisto, except for the eggplant, came from the Americas. And actually, Sevilla was an intellectual and cultural center of Spain in the 17th century, and the principal waterway to and from the Americas. It's hard to imagine Spanish cuisine without peppers, tomatoes, potatoes. None of these existed before the Spaniards traveled to the Americas.
So the Spaniards believe that the Spanish olive is the best olive in the entire world. And if you look at a lot of olive oils in the supermarket, they are going to say that they are Italian olive oil. But if you look at the ingredients, most of the time Italian olive oil is made with Spanish olives.
I buy this cold-pressed Spanish olive oil from Whole Foods, which is a little bit more expensive than the olive oil that I'll cook these vegetables in. But they're both Spanish olive oils and both cold-pressed extra virgin. Right in Hannah, the recipes that I've seen online for Pisto Andaluz, they leave the skin on. I actually prefer it with it off. Another important figure in Sevilla of the 17th century is Velázquez. He painted this really beautiful painting, apparently when he was 17 or 18 years old, of this woman serving eggs.
He's famous for Las Meninas, which I'm sure you've seen.
We're just gonna slice some garlic, some ajo, which is very common in Spanish cooking.
One of my former host mothers told me that the foundations of Spanish cooking are garlic, parsley, and olive oil. And she doesn't cook anything without garlic, parsley, and olive oil.
And that is funny, because I was just looking at my recipe for pisto and realizing that I forgot the parsley. But it is true that it is.
Well, if there's any herb you're gonna put in your Spanish food, it's parsley.
Petit heat. Okay, I'm gonna start with heating the olive oil in this cast iron pan, which I really like. So I'm gonna cook the garlic and onions over sort of a medium flame. Next, we're going to add the peppers, the eggplant, and potatoes.
So now we're just gonna add the zucchini because it takes less time to cook, and crushed tomatoes because tomatoes are not in season at the moment in Philadelphia. We're gonna add half a cup of chicken broth. You can use vegetable broth if you're trying to make this vegetarian.
Two fried eggs in this small pan with a little bit of olive oil. So while that's cooking with the lid on for about 20 minutes, I'm going to cook some fresh chorizo. The other chorizo we had was the cured type of chorizo that I got at DeBruno Brothers. Alexandra, do you want to talk a little bit about dessert in Spain?
In different host families, I've always been offered fruit for dessert and like occasionally something else, but right now we're gonna do a fun rendition on fruit.
So this is sliced oranges that we're going to peel and slice crosswise. It makes it look really pretty. It's a little bit of that sort of sweet and savory, I think, type of thing that makes it taste so good. Now we're gonna just sprinkle them with a little bit of sugar. And then we're gonna drizzle a little bit of the extra virgin cold pressed Spanish olive oil on top.
looks like our pisto andaluz is ready to eat. We thank you for watching.
Buen provecho.
Wow, that is really good.